Thank you, Rashid. This is Mungai Linne, and the question about the water development of state is, before I do that, I might just want to kind of cover two or three broad themes that at least they will remove the need for kind of repetition as one talks through these issues. One is that history matters, and that's a context. And two is the multidimensionalism of the two subjects we are discussing today, which are probably as old as human beings have been. The question of what is development, and two, what is state? Therefore, what is a development of state? And on history matters, I think the state has been around a long time, but I think I'll stick to more recent discussions. And today, my discussion will also cover the third element, which in the platform has been extremely well articulated and questioned and interrogated, the question of democracy. So I will really, in my talk today, I will combine development, the state, and democracy. And in order to set the context so that at least we at least you see where I'm coming from, the in terms of development and the state, it's contextual. And back in the probably 300 years ago, Europe was leading in terms of industrial development, and the Americans were formed by people mainly come from Europe. And the mode of production was in Europe was feudal, but across in America, they really didn't like feudalism because they were fed up with being sat on and oppressed, and they saw the kind of the emperors and the kings and the queens being extremely demanding on their what their production is, because the idea was that the serf produces in a feudal environment, then they are given a little bit and the rest goes to the owner of the feudal lord, and the feudal lord pays off to the king. So when they go into America, that is not a model they wanted. So they really set out to build what today might be called the modern democratic state. And in their case, they had one thing in advance of their mind. They got close to 6 million Africans labor from Africa, which was neither, didn't get any of the rights that the elite, the American white population had. So from that point of view, they were able to carry out their development at a time when slave mode of production was cheap. The slaves only need food and you can work them very hard. Then the Industrial Revolution comes and the steam engine comes and the slaves are breaking equipment, they are difficult to manage. So then the abolition of slavery happens, and then the abolition of slavery didn't come with economic rights. Mainly came with the right to be free. And at the same time, we are ending the 20th century. The Europeans are tired of finding themselves that these Americans are using slave labor. It's cheaper than feudal labor, so they are becoming more competitive. So 1883, 84, the scramble for Africa happens. And really it was driven by the economics. And I think what I like most is something I'm not exactly quoting it directly, but it's something that was said by Cecil Rhodes when he came out to Southern Africa, to South Africa, to current present-day Zimbabwe and Zambia. And he said for England to survive the kind of the grinding poverty of their citizens, imperialism had to succeed. That is, they had to be able to go out to the colonies and be able to bring raw materials. They are produced in the UK, and therefore they create jobs, they add value, and they grow the economy. So the slave mode of production gave way to the colonial mode of production. And there is where we find ourselves, that in the colonial mode of production, we were semi-free to sell our labor. But there were many regulations that made it very difficult for us to sell our labor. So we decided that as Africans, we wanted economic freedom, we wanted political freedom. And for us, when we fought for independence, We equated democracy with one man, one vote. And sure enough, we got it. And then, lo and behold, we discovered that actually, one man, one vote doesn't actually mean democracy. It just means that. And here is where I want to come to the question of Malta. And I think even today, the biggest democracy in the world is held up is the United States. I wonder what George Floyd and the people who are talking about Black Lives Matter, or the people who only got their rights to vote in 1963 will say about democracy in America. So democracy is history matters, it's contextual, and it's multidimensionalism. Why is it multidimensionalism? When I went to high school, my math teacher walked in and said, chickens walk on two legs. Therefore, all people who walk on everything that walks on two legs are chickens. And of course, we laughed. The point I was trying to make is the logic. That is, you say democracy is one man, one vote, it means that wherever there's one man, one vote, there's democracy. Just like if you said that human beings walk on 2 feet, so everyone who walks on 2 feet is a human being. Or dogs have emotions, so anyone who has emotion is a dog. So democracy is multidimensional in the sense that it is not one element that defines democracy. It's a series of elements that come together, just like I am a human being, I walk on 2 feet, I have 2 eyes facing forward, I am warm-blooded, I have a heart that beats a certain rate, I have emotions, I have some intelligence. All that comes to define human beings. You can't say just because I walk on 2 feet or just because I have eyes facing forward, I'm a human being. And therefore, I really feel it's important that the question of the state development and democracy be seen in the context of what they are. And therefore, is the question of the question of history and the question of multidimensionalism and the logic of it. That's one part of it. And I think I'm doing this so that the rest of the questions will be fairly straightforward. The other question is the state typologies, because a lot of the discussion is about Zimbabwe and the nature of the state. The question didn't come across as much as that, but there was a lot of discussion about the nature of the state in Zimbabwe. The second one is the dominant development theories. And finally, what the main forms of democracy. Quickly, the state typologies are failed state, which lacks monopoly on the legitimate use of laws and regulations. It cannot provide services to its people. A weak state with low or stagnant economic growth due to corruption and conflict. Three, a predatory state which puts the profits of government elite and the rest of the elite and the rich over the interests of the poor and the rest of the population, the constituents. The fourth one is the dependent state, which argues that the poor live in the periphery, nations like us in third world, developing country, Latin America, and the rich live in the metropolis, mainly in Europe and in America. The fifth one is the local development state, which has really evolved in parts of Europe, like Switzerland, but mainly in developing countries, Latin America, where the municipal city state, they focus on tackling social inclusion, exclusion, and really is driven by the crime that went on over the years. And in order to control banditry, they feel that the cities need to have policies that promote inclusion against. And the final one is what you asked me, the developmental state. And this, at the very most of it, is basically state capitalism. It is not socialist, it's not communist, it is state capitalism. And here there are seven elements to it. One, it uses its own power as a state to extensively intervene in the economy, especially regulation and planning. Two, it's a form of state capitalism. It does not abolish the relationship between labor and capital. And so when I was talking to the trade unions, they were concerned that they thought, at least a lot of them thought, that if you have developmental state, it means the rules of the traditional relationship, labor and capital, disappear. They don't, they stay. Three, it is sufficiently internally coherent to claim to have autonomy to act as a political, with a political authority. Therefore, They, as I think Mugabe used to say, we can never be a colony again. And the idea is that they can use the state power they have to make sure that doesn't happen. Therefore, they have what they call autonomy in terms of political power. Fourthly, it has enormous control on the economy. And fundamentally, it takes a lead in macroeconomic planning, especially both fiscal and monetary policy. Fifthly, its main driver, its main raison d'etre, its main reason for existence, it says it and it articulates, is to achieve economic development at whatever cost. Finally, it tends to be characteristics of societies that come late to industrialization. Therefore, it sees that its job is to lead very rapid transformation, industrialization, in order to transform society through the developmental model, and not just see itself as a state that exercises control, like a feudal state, a slave state, or any of the other forms of state whereby the state sees itself as basically being a coercive instrument. They see the developmental state very much argues that its reason for existence is to drive economic development. And therefore, our discussion on Zimbabwe today in terms of where does Zimbabwe fit in that trajectory, it will depend on how you read those. And I'm not going to pass the judgment now until towards the end, because its indicators are very clear. The milestones, normally you can look at, when I talk about the countries that have gone through it, we go through them. And do they, the question of universality and historical, I think I've answered it. They are historical, it is contextual, it is multidimensional, and therefore developmental state of 20 years ago is not the developmental state of 10 years ago. And it cannot be the developmental state of today, and it will not be the developmental state of tomorrow. As I will, as we go through this discussion, it becomes clear. I hope that's sufficient in terms of setting the context. The third context I wanted to set while the next question is coming is the nature of economic models. And really, there are two major economic models. One is the Washington Consensus, which is all of us should be familiar with, which basically says the IMF, the World Bank, and the United States Treasury Department, all based in Washington, decide they have put together what they call a consensus of what development ought to look like. And therefore, they argue on a couple of things like fiscal discipline, you do not spend public spending, you cut it back and only mainly focus on poor, you reform taxes, you adopt market-determined interest rates and competitive exchange rates in the economy, you liberalize trade and make sure you remove trade barriers and you let foreign investors come in, you privatize state enterprises, you deregulate in order to promote competition, and you provide legal security for property rights, private property rights. Then there's the Beijing Consensus, and this is where the developmental state has come out of from. It is called sometimes the Chinese model. And really gained ground in Southeast Asia when these countries decided that the Washington Consensus was not working for them. And therefore they felt that they needed to give up to move from what they call free markets and democracy to one where they want semi-free markets, and they really are not very keen on a liberal political system. Therefore, they use the state hands as levers of the capitalism. They make sure the state, the levers of state of the state are felt very much on the economy. They do away with political liberalization. They did take a leading role in the ruling party became very important in terms of this is a Chinese model that gave way to Southeast Asia countries. They argue and put a very strong case, we are here to serve the people. They are very flexible, they were initially very flexible in terms of experimentation and looking for where innovation can take place in both in the systems and the economy. They were not very keen on the Washington consensus of the shock therapy when an economy is in trouble. They preferred gradual adjustments rather than you come in and you give it a shock. And I think most Zimbabweans who are in 1991 to 96 know what the economic structure adjustment program was. That was shock therapy. The China and East Asia countries that were the ones who really advanced the developmental model theory would say, we are not in favor of shock therapy. We are in favor of more gradual change. And they are not very keen on wholesale taking in on foreign cultures. They kind of tend to be very selective. They want a better blend between foreign culture and local cultures. This was in the beginning. Of course, it has changed. And they tend to kind of say, do the easy reforms first, see where the change happens, and then you do the more difficult ones. And you can see it in China. When they came to liberalize the economy, they decided to leave the old system alone and went to new places, almost greenfield, and created special economic zones where they experimented. What the philosophy of it, if the special economic zone fails, the old society is still at least intact. If you disrupt the whole society with the experimentation and it fails, then the whole society fails. So there's a very strong experimental element of the old developmental state. And therefore, they tended to be countries like Thailand, Taiwan, Singapore, Malaysia, South Korea, and Vietnam. However, we all forget the earliest developmental states were not in Asia. At least the one was in Asia was Japan after the Second World War. But the first developmental states was actually the United States of America. Because the United States of America, when they went there, they decided that the state is important. It's an important role to play in regulating the economy. But what they decided is to create what you call a regulatory state. Their job, they say, we will not invest in the economy, but we will regulate so that in areas where the private sector cannot make a profit, the state will invest until the private sector can make a profit. We will regulate so that the private sector does not do harm to society, to the environment, to common good services. So if you look at the American state, and it's the earliest developmental state in the current civilization, they use the regulatory state, while Japan took the more developmental model, that the state will intervene in the economy, they will invest in the economy. The Americans said, no, we will use the state to regulate, but we will also make sure that we take public sector investments in areas where the private sector cannot make a profit. In Africa, we have Botswana in the 70s. And in recent cases, we have Rwanda and Ethiopia. But those latter two have not been assessed. So one of the things that you are asking is, what did they do and where are their pitfalls? As I said, they have a strong state. They are very focused on regulations. They tend to, if one has to kind of summarize it, they use their power to regulate the interests of the local elite. The local elite is basically very strongly controlled in order to make sure that their interests do not always go against the interests of the majority. So they are very tough on corruption. Everyone knows about China. If you engage in corruption that harms society, like powdered milk that has poison element that poisons the state, or water chemicals that are actually not real chemicals, or you've participated in financial systems that leave a lot of population in ruin, they will actually try you and shoot you. Now, is that the way we should be running a developmental state? I'm not saying it should be, but you ask, the question is, where have they worked and what has succeeded? In the past, you could do a developmental state the Chinese model. You could do the developmental state in Latin America, the East Asian model. Today is very difficult to do it. And it is because social media and the sheer existence of information makes it very difficult to actually carry out a developmental state without democracy. Secondly, in a fast globalizing system, if there is a global competition for which dominant form is it going to be that dominates the world? Is it going to be liberal democracy, which is capitalism with emphasis on freedoms of the individual? Or is it going to be social democracy, which is capitalist, but says it's not enough to just guarantee the freedoms of the individual? If the freedoms of individual do not lead to greater social justice and therefore requiring greater social interventions. So there is slight difference between the liberal democracy, social democracy, in the sense that one says more or less laissez-faire, we'll regulate, the state will regulate, but basically the individual is free to do what they want. The other one says no, the individual should be at least be held responsible and accountable for doing things in terms of taxation, in terms of their consumption patterns, in terms of the various ways they live in the economy, so that we can create greater social justice for the poor. And then, of course, the third one, which really emerged, and that's why the Chinese followed, and Asia followed, and some of the African, and definitely the Rwandese, the Ethiopians, have followed, and Botswana, is what you might call democratic centralism. You have a very strong political party. It has actually internal democracy, but democracy does not extend to the rest of the society. It is internal to the party in order to produce its leadership. But once that leadership is produced, everyone in the party must obey those decisions, and everyone must follow them, and they expect the rest of society to follow them. So we are almost like in a struggle. And if you're going to talk about democratic state, you really have to ask yourself, is it possible to continue running based on a democratic centralism in the 21st century, in the era of the fourth industrial revolution? Is it possible to believe you can do liberal democracy in its traditional form in the age of fourth industrial revolution and the growing inequalities in the world and the demand for greater social justice? And the answer comes out no. So the social democracy has emerged as a halfway between, and counterpoint to that has been the social, the developmental state. For countries that are saying America and Japan took some tools of developmentalism when they were starting to compete with Europe, they used the state to create advantages for the economy, for the private sector, in order to catch up with Europe. And what China and East Asia and some of the African countries are saying, we need to use similar tools if Asia and Africa and Latin America are going to catch up with the industrialized north of Europe, of America, partly the former Soviet Union, now Russia. And China is soon finding itself in that role, that we are saying, the developing countries, the poor part of the South is saying, we want to have the same tools in order to be able to catch up with economic development, because the focus is on economic development, on the idea that if you can use those tools, you can industrialize fast. And if you can industrialize fast, you can change the social services that are available. And if you can do that, you can create development, and people, their welfare, material well-being improves, and therefore they have the time and the resources to engage in the more higher levels of political discussions, which in Africa tends to be among the elite, while the bulk of the people in the rural areas and the poor tend to kind of very much spend their time on trying to figure out, how do I get my child to school? How do I get next meal? Where do I get water? How do I get energy to cook the food for my children? How do I get a roof over my head? So in the famous Gono philosophy, Maslow's law of hierarchies, the African, the developing countries elite tend to kind of utilize that disconnect between an elite that is fairly well off, that is fairly connected to the global system, and a mass of poor people who really are really struggling at the kind of almost lowest levels of existence. And therefore, democratic, the idea of a democratic state is to try and close that gap and quickly create industrialization to bring up the poor, to make sure that the poor quickly get out of poverty and their lives improve. That's basically is the whole point of the missing argument of the developmental state. My argument is that given the 21st century, I don't think you can do a developmental state which is not democratic. And that is a challenge we have. Now, back in 2017, around November, when November happened, and we came to 2018, around that period of from 2018, there was really a big debate about whether can Zimbabwe become a developmental state, can it evolve, and this debate has not stopped. And as I said, it is also tied up with the nature of the state we have. In my view, the Zimbabwe tried, at least the government that came to power after the coup that was not a coup, the current dispensation, the Second Republic, whatever you want to call it, whatever it has, everyone has many people have different names for it. But it's anyway, the post-2017 government had produced a couple of ideas that had the rudiments of a developmental state. They talk about command economy. And in the transitional stabilization plan of 2018 to 2020, they gave that idea of command agriculture, command fishery, command mining, command irrigation, a certain level of a sense that they were trying to put together something that looked close to a developmental state. And the results have been interesting. The agriculture production, we have seen it go increase threefold to 2.7 million tons of maize. That is more maize than we have produced for probably for 20 years or more. Wheat has gone up 300,000 tons, which is only 50,000 tons short of the national requirements. So they would say that in their command agriculture, they would say they are on course to using the state, levers of the state, to at least increase agriculture production. In tobacco, they would say they use the levers of state to leverage the private sector to do contracting. Unfortunately, and this is where when we come to where has the shortcomings been, there has been insufficient regulation of the foreign contractors. And a developmental state, by its very nature, always it has a leadership or leaders, not the leadership, leaders, and they basically they mobilize the population, they mobilize the institution to say that they have a certain behavior they expect from foreign investors. There are a certain, but it's rule-based. They can say, to operate in our country, you must even give 51% shares to the local people, but not for free, they must pay for it, but it must be locally controlled. They can say, you are not allowed to bring imported goods to compete with the ones you're going to manufacture locally. We'll give you permission to set up an industry, we'll license you, but you cannot use the manufactured goods you bring from somewhere else to come and compete with our production. They also say you must obey the locally domesticated regulations on labor laws, wages, taxes, etc., etc. So if you are to ask me where we are running short, if you're going to say somebody who says we want to turn Zimbabwe into a developmental state, yes, you are putting this strong levers of state on the economy. But the regulatory part of this is falling behind. And therefore, it's falling behind on several fronts. The two most important ones is that you are not regulating the competition among the local elite, the corruption, the nepotism, you are not regulating that, and therefore you are not putting in place mechanism with consequences. That is, if you break them, there will be consequences. You are not putting in place regulations regarding the foreign investors. That is, you are free to invest, but this is the rules and framework of how you treat our people, how you pay your taxes, how you pay your wages, how you make sure that you how the local industry you are building is protected against the products you bring from outside. Because they're dealing with multinational corporations that got factories everywhere. And it's cheaper for a company to manufacture in China and bring the products here than to come and manufacture it here. Unless the government has a regulation that says, if you bring finished goods, we will put a tariff on them. Therefore, we encourage you to come and create local industry so you can create jobs. So there are some elements of it that sound like they were going towards a democratic developmental state. On the macro question, there's no doubt about Zimbabwe has always had a very strong, right from the 1923, when the Southern Rhodesia got its independence, they got what they called independence. They have always had very strong role of the state in the economy. They have always been a state-regulated economy. It went from 23 to 63, from 64 to 1980, and 1980 we took on. And it has been a continuous, very strong role of the state in the way the economy does. However, the problem comes in that is until 1980, the state was using the rules to produce an economy that benefited disproportionately. 90% or 80% of the benefit went to the 10% or 5% who are predominantly white with a small African elite and Asian elite. In 1980, we thought we could use the same model without changing it much, but change the beneficiaries. So instead of looking at a quarter million whites, we look at 8 million black people all across giving the same level of services. It is not possible. It is mathematically and economically and scientifically not possible to say, without changing the way you produce, to take the same production that meant to was targeting a quarter million to do for 8 million. So there they have a problem. And they have a target of GDP of $12 billion in the mining sector. They have a very ambitious rehabilitation construction program. They have an ambitious program of managing the monetary and macro, monetary, fiscal and monetary policies, but they have been unable to actually create the equilibrium between fiscal policy, which is reasonably doing okay, and the monetary policies where the exchange rate has been almost impossible to manage. And that, in a developmental state, that is a problem they have. Finally, because I'm afraid I'm not very good at using this technology, so following the question would be more difficult. The question of the results is that it took America 50 years to double its economy during the Great Takeoff, in spite of having all the slaves and having all the means it had at their disposal and the advantages they have. It took England around 60 years to double its economy during the early phase of the Industrial Revolution. So, about half a century. It took the East and Southeast Asia countries to double their economy every 10 years. When you grow at 10 years, it becomes exponential. And for people who are talking about developmentalism, developmental state, they look at that and say, wait a minute. And Africans are looking at and saying, what is it the East Asia countries and China have done, that they can double their economy every 10 years. Countries like with enormous resources from the colonies, from slaves, could only do it in half a century. China has, for the last 20 years, has been the leader in economic growth. So when African countries and Zimbabwe look at that, they are thinking there must be something in the way the state uses its power and leverage in the economy to produce the kind of economic growth that allows China to lift a quarter billion people out of poverty in 20 years. And this is why the African countries find it attractive. But they forget the elements that China and East Asia countries have done. Anyone who goes to Rwanda observes about the sheer level of discipline. They say they are very disciplined. There's a lot of order. You go to Botswana, people point about people come to work on time. The government discipline is fiscal monetary management policies. They go to Ethiopia, they used to say the same. You go to China, you go to Japan. In all the so-called developmental states, there's a certain behavior you see in the way the party, the government, the people, and the private sector interact and behave. When you look at the liberal democracy, there's a certain level of laissez-faire. You go to India, you hear people saying it looks chaotic, but it's democracy, it's growing. So the question is, and really this is, I'm not here to advocate for developmental state or liberal democracy, I'm here to try and put on the table the kind of framework we as Africans, and in this case Zimbabweans, and the Kenyans and the South Africans on this platform, what is it we think is going to help us in the 21st century build kind of society that allows us to lift the bulk of the poor from poverty? Because that's the whole point of development. It's not about some ideas in my head. It's about where I want, where I'm going to get the means of survival I require. And therefore, I would argue that in Zimbabwe, the best chance they have in terms of moving their needle from these early steps of, you might call, kind of playing around with the idea of a developmental state, is to look at the 2013 Constitution and implement the devolution policy in its entirety. In its entirety means you align the laws of the country with the constitution. Because if you do, that constitution has very clear provisions on accountability, on transparency, on reporting, on where elected people's power starts and stops, on what level of power you devolve to the local communities and to local authorities, what the role of the province. But as long as the constitution says one thing, and the law says something else, bureaucrats like me and citizens who are business people and citizens who are in the CSO, however much you want to do it, you have to go with the laws of the land, and the laws of the land are not aligned with the constitution. So you are falling foul of the constitution. If you follow the law, you will be arrested if you break the law. So for me, if somebody was to say, where should Zimbabwe start in terms of if they want to build a democratic, a developmental state, is to start by implementing the devolution is entirety. If they do that, I also recognize that we have a generation that has got enormous global reach in terms of information. You cannot create a developmental state of the Asian model in the era of the fourth industrial revolution, the amount of information they have. There has to be democracy with developmentalism in the state. And that means if they can consolidate internal systems in the structures, especially economic knowledge and management at the levels of the executive, legislature, judiciary, and the political party. It's not enough to say the Minister of Finance understands economics, but the Politburo members don't understand it. You ain't gonna create a democratic, you're not gonna create a developmental state. Then we have to stabilize the fiscal monetary equilibrium in favor of pro-poor policies, especially in the delivery of social services, creating jobs, and managing inflation. I think for me, those are the two areas that I think, three areas. Devolution is entirety. Make sure economic literacy is understood across society, which then comes to a certain level of discipline from the elite, from the business people, and from the citizens, and of course, create a stable macro environment. Hyperinflation just creates arbitrage, creates instability, it increases poverty, it just makes it very difficult to create any form of stable state with hyperinflation or a stable society. And I think that's where I would like to end my reflections today.